Yes, good morning dear children. Welcome to SANVI e-learning services. This is Navneeta, your physical science teacher. Yes sir. Yes, in the last class we discussed distance and displacement. Yes, so now we are discussing the topic speed and velocity. Yes, we know distance means total path covered. Yes, and displacement means we'll take the shortest distance covered by the object. And distance is a scalar quantity and displacement is the vector quantity. That means scalar quantity, vector quantity means distance will give only magnitude, right? Displacement will give both magnitude and direction. And here, speed and velocity. Yes, here speed means total distance by time. Yes, also we can say that rate of change of distance. Yes, speed is also scalar quantity. That means here it will give only magnitude. Yes, and velocity. Velocity means here it is vector quantity. That means the rate of change of displacement. Yes, we'll take displacement by time. It will give both magnitude and direction. So here, I already explained the SI units of velocity and speed. So speed and velocity, the SI units are same, meter per second, right? So up to here we are completed. Now I'll start from here. So one question for you here. The person started his journey at the point A. He traveled through points B, C, D, E, F. Yes, the person started his journey at the point A here. And he traveled through points B, C, D, E, F. Right? After some time, again he reached the point A. Okay? Here. AB equals to, what is the distance here? 3 kilometers. Okay? So here, the from point A to B, the distance is 3 kilometers. And from point B to C, the distance 5 kilometers. And from C to D, the distance he travels 6 kilometers. And from D to E, 2 kilometers. Right? And from E to F, distance 4 kilometers. And from finally F to A, 3 kilometers. Just we are assuming the distance here. Yes? So, in which, what time he traveled this total distance from A to B, B to C, and C to D, D to E, E to F, and again he reached the point A in 30 seconds. So, here we need to find what is the speed and velocity of the car here. Yes. First, speed. We know speed is equals to the rate of change of distance with respect to time. Yes. So here we'll take the total distance traveled by the car in 30 seconds. So what is the distance here? We'll take total distance from A to B and B to C. And C to D, D to E, E to F, and F to A. Here, A to B 3 kilometers plus B to C 5 kilometers plus C to D 6 kilometers. And from D to E 2 kilometers. And plus E to F 4 kilometers. And finally, F to A, 3 kilometers distance. Total time, 30 seconds. Okay. Now, when we add all these terms, we'll get 23 here. So, 23 kilometers by 30 seconds. Here, this distance is in kilometers here and time is in seconds. So, we need to change this kilometers into meters. Yes, we know 1 kilometer is equals to 1,000 meters. So here we have 23 kilometers. That means we need to do 23 into 1,000 here. So we'll get here 23,000 kilometers. Okay, sorry, here this is 23,000 meters. This is by 30 seconds. So here, when we want to do calculation, we want to do here 23,000 divided by 30 seconds. So we'll get 766.666 like that. We'll get the value like this. Okay, 766.66 meter per seconds. Or simply we can say that 23,000 meters per 30 seconds. The speed of the car here. Or also we can see that 766.66 meters per second. Now, here what is the velocity of the car? Here velocity of the car equals to zero. Why the velocity of the car equals to zero? Here, the car traveled distance from A to B, B to C, and C to D, D to E, E to F, and again reached the point A only. Yes? So here, we can see that velocity means the rate of change of displacement with respect to time here. Displacement means we'll take the shortest distance covered by the object. What is the shortest distance here? Again, the car reached the point A only, where the journey started there only the journey stopped, right? At point A only, the journey stopped here. Then what is the shortest distance here? From point A to point A only, the journey stopped, started and stopped. So we can see that here, the displacement is zero. So displacement zero means velocity is also zero. Yes, here the velocity of the car equals to zero. Okay. And now, next one. Here, average speed and average velocity. Up to now we learn speed and velocity. Now look at here, average speed and average velocity. Here given some information. A train named Telangana Express starts at 2 p.m. from Sirpur Kagaz Nagar and reaches Hyderabad at 8 p.m. the same day. Yes, here the train named Telangana Express starts at 2 p.m. from Sirpur Kagaz Nagar. Okay, and reaches Hyderabad at 8 p.m. the same day. You can see the picture here given from Sirpur Kagaz Nagar to Hyderabad. Here we have to draw displacement vectors from Sirpur Kagaz Nagar to Kazipet and Kazipet to Hyderabad and from Sirpur Kagaz Nagar to Hyderabad. Okay, here we need to draw displacement vectors from Sirpur Kagaz Nagar to Kazipet and Kazipet to Hyderabad and from Sirpur Kagaz Nagar to Hyderabad. Here the distance of the entire trip from Sirpur Kagaz Nagar to Hyderabad be 300 kilometers. Okay, they are given from the total distance from Sirpur Kagaz Nagar to Hyderabad, 300 kilometers. The journey time is 6 hours. Yes, here at Sirpur Kagaz Nagar, the time 2 p.m. And when the train reached Hyderabad, the time 8 p.m. Right? So the journey time is 6 hours here. So here, what is the question they are asking? What is the distance covered by the train in each hour? The distance covered by the train in each hour. So here, total distance given 300 kilometers and time given 6 hours. We know here distance means we'll take total path traveled by the object. Yes, here what is the total path? 300 kilometers and the time given 6 hours. So 300 kilometers by 6 hours. Here we don't need to change from kilometers to meters because here time given in hours. So we'll get here, we know 6 ones are 6 and 6 fives are 30. So 0 is there, so 0. So 50 we got here. That means 50 kilometers per hour. The train travel distance 50 kilometers per hour. So in 6 hours, the train travel total 300 kilometers. Now, can you say that the train has covered exactly 50 kilometers in each hour? Can we say that? No. Because there may be some variations in distance covered by the train each hour. Okay? So here we take the average of distance covered by the train for each hour to decide its average speed. We cannot say here the train has covered exactly 50 kilometers in each hour. There may be some variations in distance covered by the train in each hour. Yes? So here we need to take the average of distance covered by the train for each hour to decide its average speed. So the distance covered by an object in unit time. The distance covered by an object in unit time is called average speed. Okay. Here average speed equals to total distance by time taken. So here the displacement of the trip. In this example, 120 kilometers due southwest. Okay. Here the displacement of the trip be 120 kilometers due south to west. Then what is the displacement in each hour? Here, the displacement per hour is 120 by 6 hours. Here given the total time 6 hours, right? Here the journey started at 2 p.m. at Sirpur Kagaznagar. And the train reached Hyderabad at 8 p.m. Here the total time is 6 hours. And the displacement given here, 20 kilometers due south to west. Here magnitude given as well as direction also given. We are finding the displacement of the train now. Right? So here, the displacement in each hour is 120 by 6 due south to west. That means we'll get 20 kilometers per hour due south to west. So the displacement of an object per unit time is called average velocity. The displacement of an object per unit time is called average velocity. So average velocity is a vector and is along the direction of displacement. So we can say that average velocity is equals to total displacement by time taken. Okay. So here we'll take total displacement by time taken. Here this average velocity is a vector. It will give magnitude as well as direction. Okay. Now, here, the quantities average speed and average velocity explain the motion of a body in a given time interval. Okay, they do not give any information about the motion of the body at a particular instant of time. Remember this point, that do not give any information about the motion of the body at a particular instant of time. Here, this average speed and average velocity explain the motion of a body in a given time interval. Now, here, take this as a screenshot and find out the answer.
I'll keep for 5 seconds. Take as a screenshot this. Find out the answers.
Yes. No. I'll give you one more example for this average speed and average velocity.
Here, average speed means I said total distance by total time. For example, a car traveled from distance point A to point B. And from point B to point C. Here the distance from point A to B is 30 kilometers. And the time 5 seconds. And here from B to C, the distance 40 kilometers. And the time 6 seconds. Assume that. Then what is the average speed of the car or any object here? We know average speed means total distance by here average speed is equals to total distance by total time. So here from point A to C, 30 kilometers. From B to C, 40 kilometers. The time from A to B, 5 seconds. And from point B to C, time 6 seconds. Right? Now, total distance by total time. Here, what is the total distance from point A to B? That means AB plus BC by, again, AB plus BC. So the distance from A to B, 30 kilometers. And from B to C, the distance, 40 kilometers. By total time, A to B, 5 seconds. And plus B to C, 6 seconds. Now here, 30 plus 40, that is 70. By 5 plus 6, 11. Here, this is 70 kilometers by 11 seconds. Okay, so here this is in kilometers, 70 kilometers by the time is in seconds, right? So we need to change this kilometers into seconds, sorry, meters. So we'll get 70,000 by 11 meter per second. This is the average speed of the object. Like this, we need to find total distance by total time. And next, average velocity. So average velocity equals to total displacement by total time. So here, for example, the person started his journey at point A and he reached the point B. The distance he traveled 3 kilometers in 5 seconds, assume. And again he traveled from point B to point C, the distance 4 kilometers, and assume that the time 6 seconds. And again, he reached from point C to A. Then what is the distance of this journey from C to A? What is the distance here? Yes, here we need to find the distance of this from point C to A. We know average speed is equals to, we'll take total distance by total time. So what is the total distance here given? 3 plus 4 by 5 plus 6. Distance is a 3 kilometers plus 4 kilometers by 5 seconds plus 6 seconds. So here we'll get 7 by 11 kilometers per second. Or we can take 7,000 meters per second. This is the average speed. Okay, this is the average speed. We need to find the average velocity. What is the average velocity here? How can we find here average velocity? So here we need to find this point C to A. So here, A to B, the distance 3 kilometers in 5 seconds. And from B to C, 4 kilometers in 6 seconds. Here, we need to apply here Pythagoras theorem. Okay. According to that theorem, we need to write here AC square is equals to AB square plus BC square. We don't know the AC square. What is the AB square? So AB, that means 3 kilometers square, plus BC is the 4. Then 3 square is the 9, and plus 4 square is the 16. 9 plus 16 is equals to 25, right? So here we got AC square is equals to 25. Then what is the AC value? 5. So here we got AC is equals to 5. The person traveled the distance from C to A is 5 kilometers. Okay, so he traveled the distance from A to C is 5 kilometers. Okay, like this, we need to find the average velocity and average speed of the any object. And next, which? Now, observing the direction of motion of a body. Here, we are observing the direction of motion of a body. Look at here carefully. So here, carefully drill a small object tied at the end of the string in the horizontal plane. Yes, here we are drill a small object tied at the end of the string in the horizontal plane. And release the object while it is drilling on the string. Here, in what direction does it move? When we drill a small object at the end of the string in the horizontal plane, so when we release the object while it is drilling on the string, in what direction does it move?
So here it moves tangential to the circular path. Okay, it is tangential to the circular path of the relief. In what direction does it move? Means it moves tangential to the circular path of the relief. Yes, here given, try to release the object at different points on the circle and observe the direction of motion of object after it has been released from the string. So here we have to take one circle, right? So on the circle we have different points. We have to release this object on different points and we have to observe the direction of motion of object. Yes, after it has been released from string. In each and every point, we have to observe the direction of motion of the object. So here, already I said, it moves tangential to the circular path of the drilling. So here the direction of velocity is tangent to the path at a point of intersect. Here the SI unit of velocity is meter per second. I already said for speed and velocity the SI units are same, meter per second. Here, in our daily life, we must have observed many motions. Yes, in some cases, the velocity of an object which is in motion is constant, but in other cases, it continuously changes. So here we need to find which motion is called uniform motion and which motion is called non-uniform motion and why. Now uniform motion. Here we need to consider a cyclist moving on a straight road. Okay, the cyclist moving on a straight road. The distance covered by him with respect to time is given here on the table. So I'll show you that. Here we need to draw distance versus time graph for the given values. So here mentioned that the cyclist moving on a straight road. Okay. Now here given the distance covered by him with respect to time. Here, time given in seconds and distance given in meters. Yes, now we need to draw here graph between this distance versus time. We are taking time on x-axis and distance on y-axis. Here, time given. Uniform time given here from 0 to 1 second, 1 to 2 seconds, 2 to 3, 3 to 4, 4 to 5, like that. Here, the time is increased unit by unit. And here, you can also observe the distance. Here, distance is also same here. The distance is from 0 to 4 and 4 to 8 and 8 to 12, 12 to 16. Here, the distance between two points is also same. Yes, 0 to 4. And next from 4 to 8. So the average between them is 4. And 8 to 12. Again, the average is 4 here. Right? So here, given uniform time and uniform distance. So that's why they mentioned the cyclist traveling in a straight. straight road, right? So here, when we draw the graph for this time and distance, we'll observe the graph in straight line. Okay. So here the time is zero. Here the time is on x-axis and distance is on y-axis, right? So here I want to take time on x-axis 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, right? And here distance 0, 4, 8, 12, 16, right? Here, at the time of 0, the distance is also 0. Yes, here. And next, at the time of 1 second, the distance is 4 meters. Here. And next, at the time of 2 seconds, the distance is 8 meters. And next, at the time of 3 seconds, the distance 12 meters. At the time of 16 seconds, at the time of 4 seconds, the distance 16 meters, right? So here, when we draw the graph for this time and distance, we'll get straight line. You can take these values and you can draw the graph also. You can observe the straight line graph. Okay. So here given uniform distance and uniform time. So we'll get here straight line path. Yes. So the straight line graph shows that the cyclist covers equal distance in equal intervals of time. So from the graph, we can decide and we can understand that the instantaneous speed is equal to average speed. Yes. So here, if the direction of motion of the cycle is assumed as constant, then we conclude that velocity is constant. Okay. Listen carefully here. If the direction of motion of the cyclist is assumed as constant, the direction is constant here. He is traveling in a straight path. Okay. He is traveling in a straight line path means here the motion of the cyclist is constant. And also we can assume that the velocity is also constant. Velocity means we can say that direction and magnitude. So here he is traveling in a straight line path. So the direction is same. And here the magnitude is also same. So we can say that the velocity is also constant. So from this we can say that the motion of the body is said to be uniform when its velocity is constant. The motion of the body is said to be uniform when its velocity is constant. Here, the person travel equal distance in equal intervals of time. That's why we got here straight line graph. Okay. Right. We'll discuss the remaining topic in next class.
Good morning, one and all. Welcome to Shanvi Learning Services. You are in plant tissues, lesson number 2, 9th class. As we have discussed yesterday, two activities we have done. Cells in onion peel and cells in leaf peel. Rio planta, leaf peel, beetle plant, leaf. See here, in activity 3, after drawing your observation, you have compared with a textual figure. Beetle leaf peel. You may have observed that the cells are present in groups. Cells are present in groups. With the help of the following activities, we shall try to find out whether these arrangements have special role to play in the plant body. Let us perform some more activities to know that. Now, activity 4. Cells in root tip. Cells in root tip. Are the cells in the roots similar to that of a leaf? Here we had observed the cells and arrangement in leaf. Now here, are the cells in the root similar to that of a leaf? Let us find out how the cells are arranged in the roots. We had observed already how the cells are arranged in the leaf. Now we are going to find out. Now we are going to observe the arrangement of cells in the root. For this we need onion root tips, right? For this we need onion root tips. So here, before going to do that activity, we have to make the onion bulb to grow the roots, because that root tip we needed as a sample to observe the cells, how the arrangement of cells is there in that root. So here, to get that, we need to grow the onion roots. Take a transparent plastic or glass bottle I shown in the figure. Okay. Take a transparent glass. Yeah, that may be plastic or glass bottle filled with water. So what you have collected, that should be transparent, because whether the roots are grown or not, we have to observe every day. Whether they are growing or not, we have to observe. So that's why we have to take here transparent plastic or glass bottle. So take a transparent plastic or glass bottle filled with water. Take an onion bulb. That onion bulb should be slightly larger than the mouth of the bottle. Otherwise, it can directly dip in the water. So it's problematic. May not get root tips. That's why we have to collect that onion bulb slightly larger than the mouth of the bottle. Okay. Put the onion bulb, what you have collected, which is slightly larger than the mouth of the bottle, than the plastic bottle, transparent plastic bottle. That onion bulb should be slightly larger than the mouth of the transparent plastic or glass bottle what you have collected. Then Put the onion bulb on the mouth of the bottle as shown in the figure number 3. Look at the figure number 3, all of you. Okay, see here, this one. Put the onion bulb on the mouth of the bottle as shown in the figure number 3. See here, observe the growth. Observe the growth of roots. You have to observe the growth of roots. For a few days, how many days? Till they grow to nearly an inch. Okay? You have to make that bulb to grow root tips an inch. So observe the growth of roots for a few days till they grow to nearly an inch. Nearly an inch. Next. Take the onion out from that transparent plastic or glass bottle what you have collected. And cut some of the root tips. Take an onion root tip. So when you take an onion root tip, you have to collect a slice thin root tip as a sample. After that, place a sample on the slide. Place the sample on the slide uniformly. Put a drop of water and then a drop of glycerin on it to observe clear image, to get clear structure under microscope. So put a drop of water and then a drop of glycerin on it. Cover it with a cover slip, as I told you in last class, to avoid dust particles, microorganisms, or avoiding from the disturbance from air. So here we need to, cover it with a cover slip. Then after that, in laboratory you will have a needle one side very sharp and other side bottom like blunt. So here you have to take that needle blunt side and a little bit press on the cover slip. Then if any excess of water is forms in that, then it will spill out, will be drain out. Okay. Then remove excess water with the help of a blotting paper, like tissue paper. With the help of blotting paper, you have to remove the excess of water which forms on the slide. Okay. Next. Here, tap the cover slip gently after removing the excess of water with the help of the blotting paper. Tap the cover slip gently and press with the blunt end of the needle or brush to spread the material. Okay. Before going to cover with the cover slip, you have to remove excess of water with the help of a blotting paper on the slide. After removing the excess of water, tap the cover slip gently and press with the blunt end of the needle or brush to spread the material. Okay, by pressing with a blunt end of brush or needle, any excess of water is there inside, then it will spill out, drained out, and we can again remove that water with a blotting paper. And by this pressure of the blunt, blunt end of needle or brush, if you press on that cover slip, that particular sample what we have collected on the slide, it will be spread the uniformly on the slide. By spreading uniformly on the slide, we can observe under the microscope very clear image, clear cut image. So tap the cover slip gently and press with the blunt end of the needle or brush to spread the material uniformly on the slide. Okay, next, observe the structure and arrangement of the cell. So as I told you, while you are going to observe that under microscope of any sample, you have to be ready with your observation book, and what you are observing under the microscope, you have to draw that in your observation book. Draw the diagram of that you have observed under the microscope. After that drawing, you have to compare with your textual figure. And try to find out the label parts. Okay. So by that you can get that particular structure. Okay. And arrangement of that particular cells in onion roots. Okay. Next, please stand line. Then observe here, cells in an onion root tip. See here, observe carefully. I'll have to look at a screen. Cells in an onion root tip. Zone of cell differentiation. Okay. Zone of cell differentiation. Zone of cell differentiation is given here. Look at the screen all of you. Okay, zone of cell differentiation. Next, zone of cell differentiation, zone of cell elongation, and zone of cell division, zone of cell division. Okay, next, root cap. This is a root cap. Fourth one is root of cap. This is a diagram what you have observed under the microscope. The arrangement of cells in an onion root tip. Here we can observe the four divisions, children. Okay. So first one, Jonas cell differentiation. Next one, Jonas cell elongation, and Jonas cell division. Next, root cap. Root cap. Okay. Next. Here, activity 5. Growing roots. Look at the screen, all of you. Be attentive. Now, activity 5, growing roots. Here, take the onion. Take the onion used in the previous activity. In activity 4, what we have used? That onion bulb we have to use here. Take the onion used in the previous activity and mark the cut end of the roots. You just mark at a cut end of the roots. See, you have to mark at cut end of the root. That particular onion only you have to collect what we have taken in activity 4. That onion, just take the onion used in the previous activity, activity 4, and mark the cut end of the roots with a permanent marker. With a permanent marker, we have to use permanent marker to mark that roots. Put the onion bulb on the mouth of the bottle in the same way as you did in the previous activity. Okay, here you have to keep that onion bulb on the mouth of the bottle. That onion bulb should be larger than mouth of the transparent bottle, glass bottle or plastic bottle. As you have done in activity 4, in the same way you have to do. Then leave this setup aside for at least 4 to 5 days. How many days we have to leave aside the setup? 4 to 5 days. 4 to 5 days. You have to leave the setup after arranging that all, as we have discussed up to now. You have to leave that setup aside for at least 4 or 5 days. 4 to 5 days. Take care that there is enough water in the glass so that the roots are submerged. Take care that there is enough water in the glass, transparent glass, so that the roots are submerged. Roots are submerged. Submerged. What is a submerged? See, you can observe lotus. Okay. Like half of the part will merge in water and half of the part will float on that. Submerge. Okay. Did all the roots grow in the same manner? What happened to the roots which had been cut off? Which had been cut off and which are not? Did all the roots grow in the same manner? Let us try to find by this activity growing roots. Already you have put a mark with a permanent marker. Okay. Permanent with a marker. You have to mark. Because to observe the difference in between that normal root tips and which you had been cut off. Write down your findings. Write down your findings regarding the cut roots and those that were not. Write down your findings regarding the cut roots. Here you have to write, you have to write the observation of cut roots and those that were not cut. We observe that by removing the tip of the onion root from the transparent glass, having a particular arrangement of cells, particular arrangement of cells. The growth of the root in length is stop. We observe that. We have to write an observation in your observation book. Okay. We observe that by removing the tip of the onion root having a particular arrangement of cells, the growth of the root in length is stopped. Growth of the root in length is stopped. You have observed that cells are present in groups. What you have observed? You have observed that cells are present in groups. Cells in groups which are nearly similar in structure. Cells in groups which are nearly similar in structure. Which are nearly similar in structure. Cells in groups which are nearly similar in structure perform similar function, children. Okay. Please note on this. Okay. Cells in groups. You have observed that cells are present in groups. Okay, fine. The which cells are in groups, and in that groups also which are nearly similar in structure. Cells are in groups, you have observed already. And which cells are in groups nearly same, nearly similar in structure, that can perform similar function, children. Cells are in group manner. The cells in groups which are nearly similar, which are nearly similar in structure, nearly similar in structure, they can perform similar functions. Similar functions. Such groups are such group of cells called tissues. Okay. So cells are forms as a group. You have observed that cells are present in groups. Cells in group which are nearly similar in structure, that which are nearly similar in structure, that cells can perform the same function. Such a group of cells which are nearly similar in structure and which can perform the same function, or which can perform the similar function, such a group of cells are called tissues. Such a group of cells are called tissues here. Okay, children, this group of cells are called tissues. Next, please stand line, all of you. Here, growth of roots in onion bulb. Growth of roots in onion bulb. Have seen. One day, Harita went to a park with Lata. Harita went to a park with Lata. There, she saw a gardener cutting the tips of the plants. What gardener is doing? Cutting the tips of the plants. Tips of the plants with a cutter. With a cutter. She has a doubt and asked the gardener to clear it. Okay. One day Harita went to a park with Lata. There she saw a gardener cutting the tips of the plants with a cutter. She has a doubt and asked the gardener to clear it. Let us read the conversation in between gardener and Lata. So Harita, how do the plants grow if the tips have been cut off? How do the plants grow if the tips have been cut off? Because gardener is cutting the tips of the plants with a cutter. So she got doubt. What is her doubt? How do the plants grow if the tips have been cut off? Then he said, who said? Gardener said, branches will grow from the sides. Branches will grow from the sides. Later she saw another gardener. That same park later she saw another gardener. Watering a stump. She went there and asked again, "Why are you watering the stump?" First, she has asked the gardener, which person is cutting the roots? So which person is cutting the branches? Okay, and she had a doubt and asked that first gardener, "How do the plants grow if the tips have been cut off?" Okay, when Harita and Lata went to a park, she saw a gardener cutting the tips of the plants with a cutter. Then she got a doubt, and how do the plants grow if the tips have been cut off? Then gardener said, "Branches will grow from the sides. Branches will grow from the sides." Later she saw another gardener in that park watering a stump. She went there and asked, "Why are you watering the stumps? Why are you watering the stump?" Then the stump will soon bear leaves. The second gardener said, "The stump will soon bear leaves." Bear leaves, second gardener said. Then Harita had a question in her mind. How will the leaves come? Of course, the first gardener said that branches will grow from the sides. And second gardener said that stump will soon bear leaves. Then Harita had a question in her mind. How will the leaves come? Do you know the answer? How will the leaves come? What is the reason behind of that growing of branches from a side, and how the stump will soon bear leaves? So to know about that, now we will study about those tissues that bring about growth, repair and other activities, right? See here, now we will study about those tissues that brings about growth, repair and other functions in plant body, which are responsible to grow the branches from the sides. Okay. Next, who are responsible to grow the branches from the side, and who are the responsible from the stump will soon bear leaves? So by studying about the tissues, we can get that clarity about the doubts. Okay. And which tissues that bring about the growth, repair and other functions in a plant body. Okay, please stand line, all of you. Now, to get the answers from the questions, further questions, here we need to get about the tissues, plant tissues, which are helping in the growth and repair and other functions. Okay, now our topic is types of plant tissues. Very interesting, children, please concentrate. Types of plant tissues, yeah, types of plant tissues. See children, basically there are four types of tissues in the plants. There are four basic types of tissues in the plants are there. They are meristematic tissue, dermal tissue, ground tissue, vascular tissue. Okay, children, there are four basic types of tissues in the plants. In that, first one is meristematic. Okay, meristematic tissue. Next, second one, dermal. Second one, dermal tissue. Next, third one, ground tissue. What is the third one? Ground tissue. Next, fourth one is vascular tissue. Okay, vascular tissue. Here, there are four basic type of tissues are there in plants. One is a meristematic tissue. Second one is a dermal tissue. Third one, ground tissue. Fourth one, vascular tissue. Okay, fine. Now, then what is the use of the tissues? The meristematic tissue, first one. Meristematic tissue. Okay, our first tissue is basic type of first tissue is meristematic tissue. This meristematic tissue that bring about oral growth and repair, children. Meristematic tissue that bring oral growth and repair. Here, growth and repair. Growth and repair. Okay, meristematic tissue that brings about oral growth and repair. Very, very important, children. Please concentrate. Next. Second one is dermal tissue. Dermal tissue. What is the use of dermal tissue? This dermal tissue that form outer covering. Outer coverings. This is helpful in outer covering. Outer covering. Okay. So these dermal tissues helpful in outer covering. And next, third one is ground tissue. Ground up tissue. The tissues, ground tissues that form the bulk of the plant body. Important. Which tissue form the bulk of the plant body? That is ground tissue. Okay. The ground tissue form the bulk of the plant body. And this tissue helping in packing other tissues. Helping in packing of other tissues. Which tissue forms a bulk of the plant body? Ground tissue. This ground tissue helping in packing of other tissues. This tissue helping in packing of other tissues. Okay? Packing of other tissues. And next, the fourth one is vascular tissue. Vascular tissue. See, this vascular tissue that help in transport of materials. Transport of materials. That is a vascular tissue which is helping in transportation of materials. Okay. So here there are four basic type of tissues in the plants. They are meristematic tissue. Second one, dermal tissue. Third one, ground tissue. Fourth one, vascular tissue. So meristematic tissue helpful in growth and repair. Growth and repair. Which helpful in growth and repair? That tissue is called a meristematic tissue. And second one, which tissue helping in outer covering? That tissue is called dermal tissue. And third one, which tissue form bulk of the plant body? Very, very important one. The tissue which can form the bulk of the plant body, the tissue is ground tissue. The use of the ground tissue is packing. Okay, this ground tissue helping in packing of other tissues. Packing other tissues. This ground tissue can form bulk of the plant body, children. And fourth one, vascular tissue, which is helpful in transport of transportation of materials, that of water and food. Okay, water, minerals, and food transportation. Okay, let us discuss in next class briefly about these. Thank you, Varandal. Let us meet in next class. Thank you all.